I am Chief Judge Kim Mueller, Eastern District of California. It's my pleasure to welcome you to this panel this morning. As federal courts, we are called on to address cases involving any number of online harms, from traumatizing digital images of child pornography, to privacy violations, to cyber hate speech and misinformation. In wrestling with these difficult cases, we sometimes have to interpret and apply a law older than Google, sometimes referred to as the Magna Carta of the Internet, Section 230 of the Federal Communications Decency Act. Section 230 provides online platforms immunity from liability for most content their users post and for the platform's efforts at content moderation. There's fairly broad consensus at this point that Section 230 is ripe for revision, and legislators on both sides of the aisle have advanced reform proposals, with the most high-profile vehicles in Congress dubbed the Earn It Act. On a parallel track, some states recently have passed laws targeting online platforms' regulation of political content on the premise that platforms disproportionately suppress certain viewpoints, drawing court challenges and eliciting spirited debate. Debates regarding Section 230 in particular have been strident, as bloggers featured on the Brookings Institution's tech stream page have observed. The ongoing debate feels like a shouting match between strangers with earmuffs, each yelling in a different language, hoping that the louder they yell, the more easily they will be understood. We can assure you that today's distinguished panel will not engage in such a debate. Dean Erwin Chemerinsky and Professor Hany, Farid may disagree in some respects, but they speak basically the same language in measured tones, guaranteed to enlighten and inform, enhancing our understanding and thus our ability to do our jobs. Dean Chemerinsky, Professor Farid, take it away.
Thank you, Judge. Thank you for having us. We think this is probably one of the most critical issues facing us as a society of how to live in a very complex world where technology and the physical world intersect. We're going to talk about a number of different things here, but let's start talking about the internet in the last 20 years. And we can't pretend it hasn't been a phenomenal boom for us as individuals, for societies, for economies. It is the industrial revolution of our time, and it has happened in 20 very short years. And many, many great things have happened, from having a supercomputer in our pockets to the ability to reach people around the world instantaneously. At the same time, we can't pretend that there haven't been real harms in the form of child sexual abuse, terrorism and extremism, the sale of illegal drugs and weapons, small to large scale fraud, spectacular invasions of our privacy, and most recently, disinformation campaigns designed to sow civil unrest and disrupt entire democracies. Since we're going to be talking about Section 230 and in particular potential modifications to it around child sexual abuse, let me just focus for a minute specifically on child sexual abuse material. More than two decades ago, which in technology years is like, they're like dog years, and this is like 140 years ago, the US-based National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, NCMEC, believed that for the most part, the global distribution of child sexual abuse was a solved problem. But by early 2000, with the rise of the internet, we saw an explosion in CSAM, as we call it. Back in 2000, the average age of a child involved in CSAM was 12. It is now 8, down to infants, toddlers, and a new category called preverbal. Last year alone, NCMEC's cyber tip line received 30 million reports of suspected child sexual exploitation. That number is up 35% from the previous year and up 75% from 2 years earlier. This is not a steady state problem. The problem continues to grow, the victims become younger, and the acts become more violent. Now, while only a fraction of those 30 million cyber tip lines led to actual arrests, here's what we know about those who were arrested from a 2019 US federal sentencing report. 52% of offenses included images or videos of infants or toddlers. 48% of offenders engage in aggravated sexual conduct prior to or concurrently with the CSAM charge. That's up 35% from 10 years earlier. That means these are not just people looking at pixels on a screen. These are hands-on offenders. They are assaulting children, half of them. 84% of the cases required sentencing enhancements for images depicting sadistic or masochistic conduct or abuse of an infant or toddler. And 77% of cases required sentencing enhancements for possession of 600 or more images. The internet has been a boom for child predators. And it is not what you think. It is not the dark recesses of the dark web. It is on Telegram. It's on Discord. It's on Facebook. It's on Twitter. It's on Snap. It's on YouTube. It's everywhere. And it is in the United States. This is affecting us. The victims are here. The people looking at the material are here. And it is free-flowing on the internet, despite 20 years of knowledge of this. And I focus specifically on this because I think it's a relatively unassailable problem that we are having. But I think it is also indicative of a larger problem of online harms that we are having. I don't want to be the naysayer here, so I'm going to turn it over to Dean Chemerinsky to talk about some of the good things that have happened in the last 20 years.
Thank you. It's such an honor and a pleasure to be part of the Ninth Circuit Conference again. And it's terrific to do this with my colleague, Hany Farid. Hany is one of the world's leading experts with regard to the internet and social media. He begins by identifying problems, especially a very serious problem, regarding child sex abuse on the internet. Everything he identifies is a problem. And yet, if we're focusing on Section 230 of the internet, I think he's beginning in the wrong place. I think we need to begin our discussion by recognizing that the internet and social media are the most important medium for speech that's been developed since the printing press. Let me just take a moment and say why I don't think that's hyperbole. First, the internet and social media democratize the ability to reach a mass audience. It used to be in order to reach a large number of people, you need to be rich enough to own a newspaper or get a broadcast license. Now, anyone with a smartphone, even access to a modem, can reach an infinite number of people. We think of things like Twitter, TikTok, YouTube, Facebook, and so many other platforms that make this possible. Second, the internet and social media provide access to unlimited amounts of information. The Supreme Court has often spoken of how the First Amendment protects the right of access to information. If we were privileged as children, maybe we had an encyclopedia in our home. Maybe there was a small local library. For those my age, you remember if you wanted to do legal research, you had to go to the law library and look at the digests. Now we have access to unlimited news sources. Many of us read many newspapers a day. I think in terms of medical information, is there anyone in this room who hasn't looked up a symptom online or tried to receive medical information in that way?
But you have to ask what happened after that.
We can come back to that. The internet and social media provide a way of disseminating arts and culture. We have access to all the leading museums in the world. Third, the internet and social media facilitate communications among people and among communities. On Facebook, 100,000 times a minute, somebody is friending somebody else. Communities form. Remember my family, who not long ago had cancer, joined a community and learned a great deal about treatment by talking with others. Certainly facilitates communication among people from minority groups and provides an opportunity for linking up with people with common interests. And fourth, the internet and social media transcend international boundaries. It is very difficult for any country to completely cut off its population from news and information, though many still try to do so. So the challenge that we face is how to deal with the problems that Hany identifies, all serious problems, without losing the benefits of free speech that the internet and social media present. And at least at this point, I haven't seen a proposal that comes to a way to accommodate these competing interests.
All right, so before we dive into 230 and the protection, Erwin's absolutely right, of course, in terms of the boom for free speech, but let me make a few caveats here. On Twitter, in the United States, 5% of people represent 80% of tweets. And those people are journalists, politicians, and actors. Hardly people who had trouble reaching an audience prior to Twitter. It is the mother of all echo chambers. And this is not always the way Twitter has been. It's where it has gone. And this is the same thing on Facebook, the same thing on Instagram, the same thing on TikTok. You see a relatively small number of people dominating the views, the likes, the shares, and the retweets. And then lots of other people either being marginalized or moved off the platforms because of abuse or hateful contact. So I agree that the mechanism is there for a phenomenal reach, but that the people taking advantage of it are a relatively small number of people, and you see that on all the major platforms. Did you want to respond to that, or should we do?
Well, I think we should talk about Section 230.
Okay. So let's talk about Section 230. It's, after all, in the title of the session here. I mean, that never stopped me as a professor from deviating, but here we are. Central to understanding 230 of the Communications Decency Act of 1996, as you said, before I think Google was even a glimmer in the eyes of its founders, are two cases that predate CDA. So let's just talk briefly about this. The first is 1991. It was Cubby versus CompuServe, involving the publication of a libel on a CompuServe forum. This is in the old days of chat rooms, not the sort of social media that you know today, where people would just chat, largely unregulated. The court found that CompuServe could not be held liable for the defamatory content, in parts because they didn't moderate content. They never looked at the content, they had no rules, and so there was no sense that they were an editor and that they were more of a distributor than a publisher. Okay, so that was in 91. 4 years later, Stratton Oakmont versus Prodigy, very similar type of case. Prodigy was being sued for libel on their services, and in this case, the court found that Prodigy was liable, was responsible, because they used automatic software and guidelines for making editorial decisions. And that seemed like a really strange decision. You had one company that was trying to do the right thing, but was held liable. Another company that said, well, we don't care what happens, and they were not held liable. And this got the attention of Representatives Chris Cox and Ron Wyden, who in 96 added an amendment to the Communications Decency Act, which, by the way, was focused on making sure that kids didn't receive sexually explicit material. And that amendment is what has survived, and that is what is now known as 230. And let me just read the two most critical parts of Section 230. It's the so-called Good Samaritan Law. And it reads, and I quote, "No provider or user of an interactive computer service, social media, for example, shall be treated as the publisher or speaker of any information provided by another information content provider." So if Erwin posts something to Facebook, Facebook is not responsible for what he posts. So that's number one. They are not responsible for third-party generated content. Number two, no provider or user of an interactive computer service shall be held liable on account of any action voluntarily taken in good faith to restrict access or availability of material. So if I do take down content or I do restrict access, you cannot hold me liable. And this is where Florida and Texas run into trouble, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. By the way, the CDA in Reno versus ACLU was struck down a year later by the Supreme Court, but Section 230 survived, and it is considered by most, the Magna Carta, the 17 most important words that have allowed the internet to be created today, both for good and for bad. And I'll let you say a little bit about it.
Jeff Kosoff wrote a book titled The 26 Words That Created the Internet. And if Section 230 is interesting, I recommend his book. Mm-hmm. Let me just say a few words about why Section 230 is so crucial. I think we can only talk about how to reform it with that in mind. First, there's a staggering amount of content put on the internet every day. The more there's imposition of liability on internet companies, the more they will have to do screening, and the less there'll be speech available for all of us. Just to give you some statistics, there's 4.75 billion items put on Facebook every day. There are 350 million photos put on Facebook a day. 243,000 photos are put on Facebook every minute. There are 10 billion messages sent over Facebook a day. In terms of tweets, there's 6,000 tweets sent every second, 350,000 sent per minute, 500 million sent every day. Now, I think it's very important to keep in mind that there still is content moderation going on. Section 230 says that there's no immunity if a platform has material that violates federal criminal law, copyright law, or federal or state sex trafficking laws. What we're really talking about is, to what extent should there be greater liability and therefore more content moderation, keeping in mind the staggering amount of information? Second, Section 230 protects user-generated content. How many of us in this room have ever looked at reviews on Yelp, or have ever used Wikipedia, or other things that are user-generated content? If we would create liability for the social media companies for anything that's defamatory, none of that material, or very little of it, could survive. Third, and I think this is often overlooked, Section 230 avoids government control and puts the responsibility for control in private social media companies that don't have to comply with the First Amendment. It's crucial to our discussion to remember that all of the entities we're focusing on today, the large social media platforms and the small ones, are private entities. The choices that they make with regard to content moderation do not have to comply with the First Amendment. If the government were to impose requirements for content moderation, those requirements would have to follow the First Amendment. So I think one of the genius aspects of Section 230 is it does create a mechanism for content moderation. Content moderation goes out all the time, but not content moderation that has to meet First Amendment standards.
Good. So let's talk about the scale of the internet. I think those numbers are about right, and they're increasing at a rate that is unimaginable, honestly. But here's the thing, is that that sort of hides the truth about content. The fact is that there are billions of uploads to Facebook every day. But all that content is not equal for Facebook. It doesn't treat the content equal. Understand that when you go to Facebook, you have a curated news feed. The 11th Circuit, by the way, did a very good job in explaining how the curation happens in their ruling on the Florida case. I think it's in your reading packet. And so what that means is that Facebook reaches into those billions and billions of pieces of content. It selects specific content for you based on your data, your past behavior, where you've been, what you've looked at. It slaps an ad on it and delivers it to you so that you spend more time on the platform. So when the companies refer to the size of their platforms as a barrier to entry for content moderation, I think that defies the basic facts of how these platforms work, which that they are curating content every minute of every day. YouTube is even like this. 70%, 70, of all content viewed on YouTube is recommended by YouTube, which is a little surprising because you would think somebody sends you a YouTube link, you watch a video, and you go home. But there's the watch next, there's the autoplay, and that's where all the action is. And so when it comes to content moderation, the problem is not billions of uploads a day. It is the specific pieces of content that you choose to deliver to users based on your algorithms, and that problem is more manageable, number one. Number two, YouTube and Facebook, from their first days, banned legal adult pornography. And they did that because it was bad for advertising business. Advertisers didn't want their ads on this type of content. And they have had no problem doing content moderation when it comes to adult pornography. In fact, they're quite good at it. It's hard to find that material on YouTube and on Facebook. Twitter moderates it, but in a slightly different way. And the same thing is true of copyright infringement. After DMCA, we got pretty good at finding and removing copyright infringement because the financial incentives were there. So I agree with Erwin that the internet is big, massive, but we have seen effective content moderation happen when it's in the business interests of the platforms, and then when it's not, we hear the argument, well, this is just too hard of a problem. And understand that this is because of the underlying business model. The business model for the last 20 years of the major internet companies is user engagement, ad-driven business. And the line is, if you don't pay for the product, you're not the customer, you are the product, right? And that is the way the internet works today. And this is an artifact, I would argue, of the business model today. I'm gonna add one more thing about the reviews. By the way, you shouldn't read reviews online, they're all crap. You just shouldn't read them. Amazon, Yelp, first of all, most of them are bots. There's a new racket going around, by the way, where people write bad restaurant reviews and then email the restaurant and say, give me $50 or I'm going to put another one up. Reviews are, for the most part, complete crap. You shouldn't rely on them. That was just a, that has nothing to do with 230, by the way, Erwin. I just, you know.
I think Hany is right in that there's already great content moderation going on. Facebook says that between October of 2021 and December of 2021, it took down 7.7 million items that were supporting terrorism, 8.2 million items that were bullying and harassment, and 19.8 million items that were child exploitation. Now, of course, we don't know the denominator there. We don't know how much is there that they didn't take down. But he's right, there's content moderation. But the question is, should we expand liability by repealing or substantially revising Section 230? And here I have great concerns. One is a First Amendment concern. If the government were to say, take down all material that supports terrorism, they would violate the First Amendment for vagueness and overbreadth grounds. If the government were to say, take down anything that's bullying and harassment, that too would surely violate the First Amendment. Even saying, take down child exploitation without a more specific definition would violate the First Amendment. So by having the private companies do this, we don't have those First Amendment issues. And the question is, could we revise Section 230 to deal with those problems better without the First Amendment issues? Second, the more we expand liability for the social media companies, the more we force them to do more content moderation, the less speech that there'll be. And so if we were to say to the social media companies, you're liable for anything that's put up there that's defamatory, or you're liable for anything that's put up there that invades privacy, the loss of speech over the internet and social media would be tremendous. So the benefits of the internet and social media are more speech. Speech can be good or speech can be bad. The internet has provided us both. The question is, how do we deal with the bad without losing more of the good?
Yeah. So this is that. You're absolutely right that they do content moderation. We don't know how well they do it. As you said, we don't know what the denominator is. So what does 7.7 million pieces of terror-related content mean? Is that 1% or is it 90%? According to the latest Facebook whistleblower, it's less than 5% of the harmful content. This is what we think it is. Okay. So that's number one. Number two is Facebook didn't come to dealing with terrorism and bullying and CSAM easily. It has been a fight for 20 years. And so this was not something that they wanted to do. So I will tell you, back in the early 2000s, when I got involved in the child sexual exploitation space and developing technology to find and remove it, every single major tech company dragged their feet year after year after year, some for decades, before they eventually deployed the technology, which was given to them for free, by the way. And so while we can look at today and say it is better than it was 20 years ago, I would argue it's not nearly as good as it could be. I agree with Erwin that we have to be careful with the chilling effect of over-moderation, but that is not the problem we have today. We have not seen over-moderation due to copyright infringement laws. We have not seen over-moderation due to child sexual abuse, dealing with child sexual abuse or with terrorism. And arguably, it is continually under-moderating. But now let's transition to 230, if we can, to reforms. Because Erwin's right, we have to tread lightly here, both for constitutional issues, but also for stifling innovation and stifling an open and free internet that we want. So let's talk about where are we in 230 reform, because it has been talked about for the last few years, and as you said, with very, very loud voices, but not a lot of agreement. So at last count, we had a couple of students do a bookkeeping on this. There's over 50 congressional proposals to either amend or repeal Section 230. They fall into two broad categories. One is to force more moderation, and the other is to force less moderation, largely along partisan lines. Conservatives think that there is over-moderation, and Democrats think that there is under-moderation. By the way, all the data suggests that the claim that social media, in terms of their moderation policy, is anti-conservative is false. Conservative voices dominate Facebook, they dominate Twitter, and they dominate YouTube. And so the premise that somehow content moderation is disproportionately affecting conservative voices is not supported by the data. I realize we're living somewhat in a post-data fact world, so, but never mind. Okay, so Most notably, along this very partisan issue, has been a Florida and a Texas law that tried to indirectly amend, I would say, 230. So, in May of 21, Florida Governor DeSantis signed into law the Stop Social Media Censorship Act, SB 7072, which greatly limited the ability of social media companies to moderate content. The law was, I mean, even by my naive standard, I'm a mathematician by training, was obviously unconstitutional because the First Amendment prohibits private entities from being forced to publish other people's speech, and it ran afoul of 230. The U.S. Court of Appeals in the 11th Circuit upheld a ruling that blocked the implementation. As I said earlier, it was a very, very good ruling, particularly on the technology side of things, understanding the way the technology worked, and that law has been struck down. Undeterred, in September of 2021, Texas Governor Abbott signed HB 20, which was modeled after the Florida law and tried to penalize companies for moderating content. Judge Robert Pittman in December of 21 blocked the law for the same First Amendment reason. That was lifted by the Fifth Circuit. It was appealed to the Supreme Court, and it was stayed. It was, I don't know what the right word is, Erwin. Supreme Court suspended the law pending a full review from the Fifth Circuit. Okay, got through that. All right, so those were deeply problematic laws because they ran afoul of the First Amendment. So in some ways, Section 230 doesn't even apply here. The most significant changes to 230 have come around child sexual abuse. In April of 2018, then President Trump signed into law SESTA FOSTA, which clarified that it's illegal to knowingly assist, facilitate, or support sex trafficking, and amended 230 safe harbors to exclude enforcement of federal or state sex trafficking laws from its immunity. SESTA FOSTA, one was the House, one was the Senate side, which then they got unified in a bit of a mess, honestly, was largely going after Backpage. If you don't know what Backpage was, it was a dark, nasty place where people trafficked illegally, and particularly young children, and they had escaped criminal and civil liability year after year after year by hiding behind 230, and that really annoyed a lot of people because it seemed like a clear misuse of the 230 Good Samaritan law. This was anything but a Good Samaritan, and SESTA FOSTA went after that. What is interesting about it is before SESTA FOSTA was passed and after, there have been very loud voices on both sides claiming that this is going to destroy the internet for different reasons. Some said that it would lead to over-moderation, as Erwin was suggesting earlier. Others were saying it would help, it would hurt sex trafficking. Neither seemed to have happened. The internet is basically the same as it was. I think there's only been one prosecution under SESTA FOSTA. It did shut down the classifieds of Craigslist, and Backpage eventually went away, but that was for a different reason. It does not seem to have had any effect on crimes against sex workers. There's a very nice study out of CMU that looked at crimes against sex workers before and after SESTA FOSTA. There was a slight drop in arrests and crimes against sex workers right after SESTA FOSTA, and then it steadily rose, largely because other platforms stepped in that were not based in the US, and they escaped SESTA FOSTA. It's a big internet, there is no geo-blocking, and so somebody's going to create this service. And so the law didn't really do any good, but it didn't seem to do any harm. But it was the first chink, if you will, into 230. And then Earn It, which we're going to, if we have time, talk about in a little bit, is building on SESTA FOSTA to force companies to do more about child sexual abuse and some of the things that I talked about earlier.
That's a great summary. I want to start where Hany did. I think that there's consensus that Section 230 is broken and that the internet and social media are broken for the reasons Hany said at the beginning. But the problem is there's no consensus on what's the problem or how to fix it, which is why no legislation of meaning has been adopted. As Hany said, the conservative criticism is that internet companies engage in too much content moderation and especially deplatforming of conservatives. That's why Florida and Texas adopted the laws that it did. Now, the reason that the 11th Circuit declared the Florida law unconstitutional and the district court declared the Texas law unconstitutional is that the social media companies are private entities, and to regulate the speech that they're having on their platform is no different than the government regulating what the New York Times or any newspaper or media company is conveying. Also, if the Florida and Texas laws would go into effect and prevent content moderation, then the platforms wouldn't be able to take down all of the things with regard to terrorism, bullying, harassment, sexual exploitation that they're taking down now. We want the platforms to be engaging in that content moderation. Now, I should point out with regard to the Florida law, the text law, the district court issued a preliminary injunction. The Fifth Circuit, without opinion, lifted the preliminary injunction, and the Supreme Court then stayed the Fifth Circuit ruling, but four justices dissented. Justice Alito wrote a dissent, joined by Justice Thomas and Gorsuch, that indicated that he thought that the Texas law was likely constitutional. Justice Kagan wrote a separate, or dissented separately. She didn't write an opinion. My guess is that it wasn't about the law, but about her views with regard to the use of the shadow docket in this way, but we don't know because she didn't write. But I do commend to you the opinion by Judge Kevin Newsom on the 11th Circuit that explains why the Florida law was declared unconstitutional. Perhaps some states in the 9th Circuit will adopt laws, and these will come before you, sure that the Florida and Texas laws will make their way to the Supreme Court, if not next term, soon. On the other hand, the liberal perspective is there needs to be more content moderation. We need to deal with the problem of sexual abuse online. We need to deal with hate speech online. We need to deal with terrorist speech online. The question is how to do it consistent with the First Amendment. Let me take one example that we haven't focused on enough, and that's the problem of false speech online. The great thing about the internet, as I said, is how easy it makes to reach a mass audience. But that can be with false information. And false information undermines all the values of the First Amendment. But the Supreme Court said in New York Times versus Sullivan in 1964 that false speech is generally protected. So there's the breathing room for free speech to thrive. In United States versus Alvarez a decade ago, the Supreme Court said, again, that false speech is protected by the First Amendment. How can we regulate false speech over the internet consistent with the First Amendment? This seems to me the real problem. In terms of SESTA FOSTA, it's quite disputed whether it's had any effect at all. There's only been one criminal prosecution under SESTA FOSTA in its history, and it seems that those who have wanted to put such material on the net have found ways of doing so using foreign service providers so the information is there. Certainly, there's a great concern that SESTA FOSTA will be harmful for sex workers, make it less possible for them to use the internet and social media to reach willing and possible customers. Others believe that this is exaggerated and that SESTA FOSTA will help deal with sexual exploitation. There's just so little evidence on either side with regard to this one as an effect. To me, one of the concerns about SESTA FOSTA and one of the concerns about some of the proposals to regulate Section 230 is Section 230 largely preempts state law. Not with regard to sexual exploitation and trafficking laws, but otherwise. If we lift that preemption, then we will have each of 50 states adopting their own regulation of the internet, and that simply doesn't work for a national, let alone an international medium. We already have the problem of many different countries having varying regulations. I think as we contemplate reforming Section 230, it can't be in the direction of more empowering the states.
Yeah. Can we, before we talk about EarnIt, and because the state issue is going to come into play there too, let's talk about false speech a little bit, because I think this is, we are really seeing the impact of false speech on our society and our democracies, on our global health, for example, around COVID. Just to give you some rough numbers, we've done a series of surveys over the last few years in, to understand the reach and the belief in COVID-related misinformation. And it is pretty shocking. 20% of Americans believe that Bill Gates created COVID so he can put a tracking device in a vaccine. Here's what I'd like to ask these people. This is neither here nor there. We've all strapped the mother of all tracking devices to our face 18 hours a day. Why does Bill Gates have to put it into a vaccine? I mean, it's neither here nor there, but 20% believe that. That's insane. A significant, about 18% believe that 5G causes COVID. This is not 1-2% tinfoil hat wearing, living in your basement. This is a significant number of Americans. And then how do we respond to global health problems? How do we have open and free and fair elections if 50% of people believe that elections are being stolen? So these are not, these are fundamental existential threats to democracy. Here's the last thing I'll say about it too. It is absolutely true that the best antidote to false speech is more speech. It's true. But in the age of the internet, that only works if you have an open and fair marketplace of ideas. And we don't. And the reason we don't is because the algorithms that I was referring to earlier that decide what shows up on your YouTube feed, what shows up on your Facebook news feed, and on your Twitter feed are biased. And they are biased not conservative versus liberal, but they are biased towards outrage, salaciousness, conspiratorial, because that's what gets us clicking and liking. And so the marketplace is rigged to favor the false, the outrageous. And so the true speech can't actually compete. And now that's a really interesting landscape also. So how do you do, is it about the algorithms or is it about the speech? And I don't have a good answer for that either, by the way.
I think you're absolutely right. And if we talk about false speech, the problem is who's going to determine what's true and what's false? And in the context of political speech, do we want somebody to be determining for us what's true and what's false? I just want, before we go to questions, to say a word about the Earn It Act, because the Earn It Act has gotten probably more attention than any other proposals. It's formally titled the National Commission on Online Sexual Exploitation Prevention Act. It would create a 19-member commission. Its goal is to develop best practices for regulating sexual exploitation material over the internet. Originally, it was about an idea that if social media companies followed these best practices, they would then get safe harbors. That's why it was called Earn It, so they would earn their right to have the safe harbor like what Section 230 provides. But that's been taken out of the current versions of the Act. So now it's aspirational. Nobody has to comply with it. It's just advisory. Now, I think it's important to remember there's already a duty that exists. If a platform knows of child sexual abuse exploitation material, they must inform the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, the entity you were talking about before. And the question is, what would the Earn It Act do in addition? I have a lot of concerns about the Earn It Act. I have concerns in terms of the 19 members, if you look at it, almost all law enforcement, almost no privacy experts or First Amendment experts on it. I worry in terms of what it would mean in ending encryption. We haven't talked about the privacy aspects or the Fourth Amendment aspects of all of this. But one of the advantages of social media is the opportunity to speak with encryption and speak privately. Just to put this in a very concrete context, think of women post-Dobbs, who want to be able to communicate with reproductive health care facilities without having any danger of it being exposed and leading to their prosecution. Ending encryption puts that very much in jeopardy. Also, the Earn It Act, had it gone into effect as originally drafted, would have created the opportunity for liability under state law, and then you get to exactly the problem that I was talking about of 50 states with different standards, and how could that possibly work when you're doing national internet and social media companies?
So first of all, you're absolutely right about the state issue. Earn It explicitly says that you can sue civilly at the state level, and that was seen as filling a gap that SESTA FOSTA left behind. I agree with you, by the way, that regulating it at 50 states is incredibly messy, although arguably we're already doing that with hundreds of countries. But I agree that's hardly ideal for us. Let me just mention two things about the encryption, because this is where things get very testy when we talk about regulation, is around privacy and encryption. So first of all, let's clarify that we're talking about end-to-end encryption and not encryption. So let me just distinguish between those. Mm-hmm. So encryption is I log on to my bank account and I send some information over the wire. It is encrypted on my device. It is sent to my bank and the bank decrypts it. And that means anybody sniffing the wire in between cannot see the information. Nobody's talking about eliminating encryption. We don't have commerce without encryption. End-to-end encryption is a little bit differently. So if you are using an end-to-end encrypted service, like WhatsApp, for example, if I send Erwin a message on WhatsApp, my device will encrypt it. It will go through a WhatsApp server, which will not be able to decrypt it, no matter what. It's hard encryption, it does not have the key, and then that message simply gets sent over to Erwin. Erwin will be able to decrypt it. So that end-to-end encryption says no intermediary, no government, no warrant, nothing can read this intermediate message. huge boom for privacy, but also a boom for criminal activity for obvious reasons. There's an explicit, I haven't seen the last markup, but I thought the last markup of EARNIT explicitly says that if your service is using end-to-end encryption, that does not by default mean you are a bad actor. And I think that was in response, by the way, to exactly these privacy concerns. But understand that there is real tension here between individual privacy and online safety, and they are somewhat at odds with each other. There are technological solutions to deal with this, but the really strict privacy advocates will not have any technology that in any way allows for a compromise of fully bulletproof end-to-end encryption. I happen to disagree with that. I think we have to have compromises, but that's where the tension is. I think we have about a minute left before Q&A. Are we okay, Judge? Okay, if you wanted to say the last words.
I hope that the takeaway from this is just that you see the complexity of the problems. I think both Hany and I agree in terms of the importance of speech over internet social media. We both agree in terms of the problems with regard to sexual exploitation material, false speech over the internet. But what we're all struggling is, how could Section 230 be reformed to be able to better solve the problems while still protecting speech?
Yeah, we don't have any answers. That's it, though. Thanks, everybody. And we're on time, too.
What's the point in having a panel of the world's experts without answers? But by asking the right questions, we will ultimately get to the answers. Here are a few questions from the audience, and I see a few more coming. First, what does good faith mean in Section 230, and what are examples of bad faith?
Thanks.
I'm not going to make the legal inference of that. I'll leave that to Erwin. The clause was very much meant to be a Good Samaritan law. The law was meant to say that if you are acting in good faith, I don't know how to define that legally, but if you are acting in a way to simply enforce your rules, you should have safe harbor. The problem was that many people used 230 and got protection from 230 appropriately, but then we had bad Samaritans. We had the back pages of the world. We had the Chan networks, the Chan groups where people were knowingly trafficking and they were still getting protection, knowingly what they were doing. I don't know what the legal definition of good and bad faith are, though.
Everyone in this room knows that good faith comes up in countless contexts, and I don't think there's a different definition here. I also don't think there's been a body of case law interpreting this aspect of Section 230. The only thing that I'd emphasize is something that Hany said that we didn't talk about enough. Section 230 both provides immunity from the platforms for liability for what is put there by other providers, but it also creates immunity for them for the choices that they make in content moderation. And I think it's important to keep both of those things in mind, including when we're talking about what good faith means in this context. Mm-hmm.
Here's another question. What is your response to the reports, including from former U.S. Attorney Jenny Durkin, that Backpage was more responsive to law enforcement inquiries as well as proactively reporting suspected abuse and trafficking than other platforms? Didn't shutting down Backpage make it harder to find abusers and traffickers?
I can't speak to whether Backpage was how much they cooperated with law enforcement behind the scenes. Here's what I can tell you. And this is completely anecdotal. First of all, the platform knew that they were illegally trafficking children and adults. They knew this. And not only were they the intermediary, they were helping their customers phrase the ads in order to avoid detection. And so they were not passive or good actors in this space. Here's the other thing I can tell you. I was part of the team that built a technology called PhotoDNA. This is the technology that is now in worldwide use to find and remove child sexual abuse. Almost all reports to NCMEC Cyber Tip Line come from this type of technology that fingerprints known child sexual abuse material and then finds it on upload. We approached Backpage and simply asked them to run this technology the way we did every other technology, and they literally laughed us out of the room. This was not a good player in this field. That's not to say they didn't do some good things in their time there, but this was a company that knew what they were doing and they were profiting handsomely from it, and I think we are better off for that page being, for that site being down.
And just a little bit of background, there were suits against Backpage prior to Seston Foster, where Backpage was found to be protected by Section 230. And I've often thought that Seston Foster was really directed at Backpage. Unfortunately, I don't think Seston Foster had much effect because it's been so easy for other companies to just circumvent it by using foreign servers. Backpage has gone out of existence, but I don't know that it's really done anything either in a positive or in a negative way.
I agree. I think it's been a no-op.
There are two questions related to foreign harms. If other foreign platforms that can't be regulated will step in to fill the online sexual exploitation void, what is the benefit of modifying Section 230 to force increased content moderation in this area? And then on a separate topic, bodies of the United Nations have said that Facebook contributed to genocide in Myanmar. Should Facebook be immune for that?
Okay. Man, I'm the wrong person to ask that question, because I do think Mark Zuckerberg should visit The Hague. By the way, if you don't know, Facebook has been implicated in horrific human rights violation in Myanmar, and it's not just Myanmar, it's also in Ethiopia, it's in Sri Lanka, it's in the Philippines. They've been implicated in horrific violence in India and Brazil, and here in the US for that matter. So I do think that, I mean, this is an international law question, which I'm not gonna field whether that's appropriate for them. Let me get back to the first question, is what's the point if we can simply outsource this? And I think the point is that we should have moral leadership here. This is our home. These companies are coming out of California. The top five tech companies that dominate the internet landscape come out of the US. And I think we should lead by example, if for no other reason, so that we have the moral high ground. But the better reason is that these five companies constitute a significant part of day-to-day activity on the internet. And there is always going to be bad actors, and we'll deal with those bad actors when we have to. So I still think there, even though there are going to be holes in this, if we could deal with the problems on the five biggest platforms, we will have tackled a significant amount of the problem.
I think that's absolutely right. At the time that the Communication Decency Act was adopted, and the Supreme Court handed down Reno versus ACLU in 1997, the Supreme Court said that 40% of all of the sexually explicit material was coming from foreign countries. My guess is it may even be a larger percentage now. So there is the tendency to say, well, what good would it do to regulate anything in the United States? And yet, even though child pornography might come from foreign countries, we still decide that it's important to regulate child pornography in the United States. And all of you who are judges, if you had to deal with these cases, and it does decrease the presence of child pornography, and it does do something to protect children. In terms of false speech, I had mentioned one of the virtues of the internet and social media is it breaks down international borders. That then means that false speech can come to the United States from foreign countries, as it did from Russia in the 2016 election. But even if we can't deal with that problem, we still need to confront the problem of false speech that's generated in the United States. And if we could find a solution for some of that, it would make speech better in this country and make the First Amendment work better. So I think it's wrong to throw up our hands and say, because there's foreign things we can't control, we don't want to do anything in this country. There's too many examples where there's foreign things we can't control, but we can still make a difference on what's here.
Let me add one more thing to this too, by the way, which is that it's one thing to say, well, okay, I set up my servers in the Netherlands, which affords great protection. But no company lives in isolation. So companies need infrastructure. They need the folks hosting the DNS, their name server. They need Cloudflare to protect them against attacks. Almost everybody these days needs cloud computing, which is Amazon, Microsoft, and Google. All of these are US-based companies. So it is hard to do business today. You want to host your code on GitHub? That's a US-based company, Microsoft. So technology is very complex and fully integrated. So it's not just a question of where is a server physically. You are then going to be using infrastructure. And if we have laws in this country, then we can enforce that on anybody using those services.
Can you touch briefly on what UK and EU colleagues are doing to contend with this tension?
Good.
In a nutshell, we have some other questions, but it follows so, these questions.
Yeah, so you may remember GDPR, which was the privacy law that came out of the out of Brussels, was probably the leading thinkers on privacy. Brussels is moving forward two bills, the DSA and the DMA, the Digital Safety Bill and the Digital Markets, I forgot what the DMA is. One is going after antitrust and the other is going after online safety, and the UK is moving on an online safety bill as well. Nothing is written, but these are most likely Brussels will pass DMA and DSA following on GDPR, which will put significant pressure around antitrust and online safety with massive fines for the companies that are going to have to comply. And by the way, this means it's a great time for us to be thinking about 230 reform, because the companies are going to have to deal with this anyway. So let's deal with it per your issue around too many different regulations. Let's deal with it all together. And the last people I'll add is the Australians have been very, very good at going after tech companies around monopolies and after online safety.
I think the caution here is that there isn't the same commitment to free speech in these countries. In most of those countries, hate speech, for example, is not protected. It is criminally punishable. The Supreme Court has made it clear that generally hate speech is protected by the First Amendment. We can argue over whether that should or shouldn't be, but it certainly creates an enormous problem for international regulation of speech when there are enormous differences among the countries in terms of what speech is allowed and what can be prohibited.
On that, if I may, there's an interesting case study that we've been following for a few years now around hate speech. So the Germans have very strict laws against hate speech, of course. They passed a law called NetzDG about 4 or 5 years ago, which we have been following to see what are the consequences of very strict laws that hold the Facebooks of the world and the YouTubes of the world for hate speech. What are the consequences for the platforms themselves for complying with these laws? I don't think we have a good sense of whether it has chilled free speech, but what I can tell you is that the cost of complying with the law seems to be incredibly modest. Now, what has been the consequence in terms of free speech, I think, is an interesting question.
And of course, there are all sorts of reasons why regulating hate speech in this country is different than regulating hate speech in other countries. Some of it is the difficulty of formulating a definition of what's hate speech that's not unduly vague and overbroad. In the early 1990s, over 350 college universities adopted hate speech codes. Every one to be challenged in a court was declared unconstitutional on vagueness and overbreadth grounds. Also, the experience in these countries with regard to hate speech laws should cause us some pause. So often, they're used against the very people that are meant to be protected. You talk about Germany. In England, when it adopted its first hate speech law, the first prosecution under it was brought against a Zionist group, with the prosecutor saying Zionism is a form of racism and therefore it violates the hate speech law. The most frequently prosecuted person under France's hate speech law was the actress Brigitte Bardot. She's an animal rights activist and is against using animals in religious rituals and has been many times prosecuted. So I think there's a lot to learn from the rest of the world and their experience with hate speech. It doesn't necessarily mean we want to go in the direction of more regulation.
So coming back home again and thinking about our First Amendment jurisprudence, should Twitter or other platforms be considered analogous to the public square and thus First Amendment content censorship restrictions apply?
The answer to this under current law is clearly no. And then I'll say I think that's why current law is right. The question is, are the large companies like Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, Google state actors for purpose of the Constitution? And every court to rule on this has said, no, they are private companies. They don't have to comply with the First Amendment. In fact, if you read Judge Newsom's opinion from the 11th Circuit, he begins by making that point. So I think under current law with regard to state action, they are private entities. It can't be said that they fit under the exception of state action doctrine. But I also think it's a very good thing that we treat them as private companies. Because if they were the government, if they were state actors, then they couldn't engage in the extent of content moderation that now goes on. And I think what we both agree is there needs to be more content moderation to deal with the problem. Making them into the government or state actors would mean they'd be less able to do that.
I'm not going to disagree with that.
Thinking about the disincentive question that you raised, Professor Farid, and perhaps other laws out there, one of us is asking, can consumer protection laws be used to address harms caused by or facilitated by platforms?
Yeah. That's interesting. You're starting to see some movement. So 230 has prevented lots and lots of people from criminal prosecution, and victims of sex trafficking, child abuse, all forms of harms, from getting their day in court. And one of the things that you are starting to see that is getting traction is treating this as a product liability problem. That is not saying that the issue is the content itself, but saying that the issue is the product itself and the way it is designed. So for example, we know that Instagram is designed to keep you on the platform for as long as possible, to keep clicking, to keep delivering ads. And that means young girls, for example, who show a propensity towards eating disorder or body image issues, get fed videos over and over and over again that reinforce these incredibly negative and harmful content, which leads to self-harm, which leads to suicide. And some have argued is that because of the algorithmic amplification based on personalized data that you have extracted from this user, this is not a content problem, this is a product design problem. I can't speak to the legal grounds of that, Erwin can, but I think it's an interesting way to think about the problem.
I think it's enormously problematic because the product is speech. It's not a product that exists apart from speech. This example is deeply troubling, but what Hany says are two factors. One is, it's speech that tries to keep people engaged. Doesn't any good book try to keep people engaged? Doesn't any good TV show? Video games are set up to keep people engaged in playing. It can't be that because it keeps people engaged, that makes it outside First Amendment protection. The other is that it's algorithmic. And it's initially tempting to think, well, if it's an algorithm, that's outside the First Amendment. Let's regulate algorithms. But the algorithms themselves are a form of speech, and they facilitate speech. So I don't think calling this a product gets us anywhere, because ultimately the product is all about speech, and you're back to the same things that we've talked about and the same underlying issues.
Here's the problem with the book analogy. When I buy a book and you buy a book, we read the same book. But you can't say that about our experiences on social media. The way social media delivers content is based explicitly and solely on data that it extracts from me, sometimes, by the way, without my consent. And so that seems very different to me than just saying, well, here's a bunch of engaging content for everybody to read, right? You're tapping in to somebody's very specific problems and then leveraging that.
Let me put aside the use of data without consent, because I think that's a totally
different issue. Problem.
All you're saying then is that because this speech is more effective, it's less protected. And that can't be right. Because the speech may be more effective because it reaches to an individual. It can't be that if it's a video game that becomes individualized as you go along, or a movie where you get to choose the ending as somehow, that therefore it's less protected than others. And so the fact that this is individually tailored doesn't make it less speech. And I'm not sure how you can regulate just on that factor without running afoul of the First Amendment.
Final question, 1 minute. You can decide how to divide this. We'll hear tomorrow from the FBI director. And some expect he may talk about end-to-end encryption. Any questions you suggest we ask him if we have the chance?
Oh, man. So first of all, I have to say this is a hot button item, the end-to-end encryption. And I don't know where I fall on it. I think there are real privacy concerns that end-to-end encryption help, and there are real measurable harms that we have from it. And how we balance those two from a policy perspective is very tricky, but also from a technology perspective. Because if you do create backdoors, lawful access, you do weaken the encryption. We have to admit that. But do we want to live in a world where bad people can do things without any form of consequences through communication services? And I don't have good answers for that. Both Erwin and I know we've talked about this, have struggled with this.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think it's exactly the trade-off that Hany suggests. On the one hand, we want to protect privacy. And I give the example now in light of Dobbs of women wanting to be able to communicate to reproductive health care facilities, including other states, and not have that communication being able to be obtained. On the other hand, we don't want people to be able to avoid criminal liability on account of encryption. And the more you weaken encryption so as to facilitate criminal enforcement, inevitably, the less you're protecting privacy. And how to strike that balance is something that no one has come up with yet.
Yeah. By the way, here's one thing you should ask him about. I think it was the FBI created a fake end-to-end encrypted app, and they got it in use by criminal organizations who believed that it was a strong encryption, and they were reading every single message coming out of it. You can ask them about that.
There you go. For whoever asked that question, even if they don't have all the answers, we guaranteed you they would enlighten and inform, and I think we have to agree. Thank you, Dean Chemerinsky and Professor Farid.
I'm so glad you did that.
Yeah, me too.